In this video, we're about to show you the best practice insulation install tips around a standard 90mm stud brick veneer home to achieve the best thermal performance. A perfect video for trades to watch just before insulation, plumbing, and electrical services are installed in a new build. Just so we get a full understanding of how insulation is going to perform to its full potential and get the best value out of it, a couple of key considerations. One is the insulation should be the full depth of the stud. So we really want the insulation sitting out here nice and flush with the front of the stud. We're going to be putting our plasterboard on. Our plasterboard is going to be the second key to the thermal performance of our building. It's going to be the air barrier. So we want our thermal insulation abutting the air barrier. What concerns us is that if we get gaps and cracks in the insulation, so if we allow air to transfer from outside and then the insulation is set back to give us an airspace, this is the sort of scenario that will show up in our thermal imaging as a lower performing area of the insulation system. So it's a matter of making sure our insulation is fully recovered out to the face of the stud, so when the plasterboard goes on, plasterboard, our air barrier, abuts our insulation, and we knock out any of that thermal leak. Within a wall installation, there could be numerous areas where the insulation will be performing poorly. So we're going to have a look at a number of those. We're also obviously going to be looking at all elements of insulation. Up in the ceiling, again, we want nice tight-fitting bats. We want them sitting level with the bottom of the roof trusses, ceiling joists, or roof beams, so that when we apply the plasterboard, that's our air barrier, and our insulation is abutting our air barrier fully with no gaps and cracks, an opportunity for cold air or warm air to transfer through. So that's what we're going to be looking at. We're going to go through those scenarios one at a time, look at some thermal imaging, just so it's fully explained to you at the end of a job when a thermal audit and the auditing process is carried out. You'll see what can possibly be poor performing areas so that we can avoid those in the construction itself. Let's have a look at one of the scenarios that I'd like to bring to your attention. Internal walls. You will generally, in nearly every case, find that this small cavity here on the outside of the building will be completely uninsulated. So what's going to have to happen here is, as the external building wrap's going on, so in our case in Victoria, cold climate, it'll be a vapor permeable wrap. As that's going on, we need somebody to go along and install these small pieces of insulation. They've got to go in all the external corners and all the locations where an internal wall frame meets an external wall frame. Otherwise, these areas here will show up as a thermal defect. Moving on to some other areas that we find commonly. Look, occasionally there'll be no insulation where the lintels occur, but commonly we find a bit of insulation put in there, but there's nothing up here where the lintel is. While we have quite a high performing insulation, a bit of 50mm timber has a very low thermal performance, so that will show up on our thermal imaging. What we would prefer to see is a bat that's installed completely. It needs to be checked out. It needs to be installed neatly, and that's going to give us a much better result. Again, just to refer to no gaps and cracks, this is obvious here that there's insulation sort of poorly installed here, so that's certainly going to show up on our thermal imaging when we audit the house. A situation here where we're using the offcuts of the insulation to fill up one of the stud spacings or a void. This is really not acceptable. Again, we've got compression, we've got gaps, we've got cracks. The insulation's not protruding forward to be flush with the plasterboard and our air barrier. So by the time you put in three or so pieces of insulation, that's about where we limit ourselves. At the point of when you're putting 6 and 8 and 10 pieces in, that is going to show up as an issue in our thermal imaging. So now if we look at bulkhead, so it forms part of our thermal envelope. What we want to do is make sure that the insulation is hard up against our air barrier. So our internal plasterboard is our air barrier. So we recommend that the bulkhead itself be fully insulated. So we insulate the face, the base, the sides of the bulkhead, and we infill insulation inside the bulkhead so that it's all pushed hard against the plasterboard so we maintain that air barrier insulation connection. Just another important comment within a house is that there may be a return air void that is unused, or it may be a decorative element of the house that's boxed out, or the end of a wardrobe zone, cupboard zone. So what happens in this case is we'll have a problem with our air tightness, because outside of this void we have ceiling plasterboard providing our airtight barrier. But within here, there will often be nothing in this place of the void. So we need to apply something at the early stages prior to the ceiling insulation that caps off the tops of these decorative voids or unused return air ducts, ends of cabinets and so forth, to maintain that level of air tightness within the house. Now, we're just going to talk from another aspect of building health, and it's in regards to your internal wet areas, bathrooms and laundries. It's a requirement that not only do we insulate the external walls, because we need the thermal performance for the building, we're going to insulate the internal walls of bathrooms and laundries to reduce what we call the temperature differential, which actually reduces condensation potential. So if we can reduce condensation to its minimum risk, we will reduce mould building up on the inside face of bathroom walls and reduce that health risk to the building. So again, from a health perspective, insulating all the internal walls of wet areas to reduce condensation and the potential of mould. While the insulation on the inside of the wall looks beautifully installed, when we come around to the back of the wall and we start to look at the locations of electrical wiring, you'll see your typical installation of wiring where it's run through the centre of the stud compresses the insulation. So we're reducing the thermal performance of the insulation in any area where the insulation is compressed. What is a better option, and our recommendation, is to actually run the electrical wiring to the back of the stud by clipping it to the rear of the stud. That allows the insulation to fully recover, allowing the full thermal performance of the insulation. So there's no erosion of the performance of the insulation when we clip the wiring to the back of the stud. We're constantly talking about the thermal performance of the building. One of those areas where the thermal performance will be interrupted is if the switchboard and all the associated wiring is within the external stud frame. So the requirement is to build a second stud frame to house the switchboard and all that wiring so that it doesn't interrupt, as you can see behind, the insulation is uninterrupted by all the wiring and work required around a switchboard. Another interruption to the thermal envelope is going to be all your plumbing hot and cold water pipes in the external walls. So rather than just installing the insulation, compressing it around the pipe, of course, losing some thermal performance, what we would prefer to do here, or what's required here, is to make a cut in the insulation where the pipework is, opening it up and just encapsulating the pipework in the insulation so we get the full performance of the insulation so it's fully recovered. So as we referred to with our wall insulation about the insulation being tightly fitting and sitting flush with the inside face of the stud, so when the plasterboard goes on, the insulation's hard against our plasterboard, which is our air barrier. We need to achieve the same result at ceiling level. So here, commonly you'll see insulation bats a little up and down, so we just need to drop them into place so they're sitting nice and flush with the underside of the roof trusses or ceiling joists. And in that case, when the plasterboard goes on, which is our air barrier, it will be hard to the insulation. There will be no air spaces, no gaps or cracks, and the insulation will perform to its full potential, and the plasterboard will be our air barrier, which is hard against the insulation. The plumber's also going to be running pipework, hot and cold pipework, through the roof space as well. Generally, he's going to be sitting it on top of the bottom cord of the truss, so when we come to insulate, the insulation can't go underneath, it'll be lifted up over the top. So no longer do we have the insulation abutting the plasterboard, we have this airspace. So the answer here is to remove the pipework from above the top, sitting on top of the bottom cord of the truss, and relocate the pipework to the underside of the top cord of the truss or one of the webs of the truss, so the insulation can be installed hard to the plasterboard, abutting the plasterboard, so we get the full recovery, no air spaces, and the performance of the insulation of the ceiling is continuous and consistent across the whole house. So this is a very important one, because often what we find in most houses is that there'll be an equipment platform which is housing your hot water service, ducted heating equipment. And often we find that this zone, being a reasonably large area of the ceiling, will be completely uninsulated. Or we find there is only a 90 mil bottom cord or truss with some structure floor or sheet flooring over the top. So we only find ourselves with 90 mil of insulation when the actual ceiling bats are going to be at least 200 to 300 mils thick. So what's required under your equipment platforms is to build them up the required height to accommodate the ceiling insulation specified. It's always going to be 200 to 300 mil thick. So these platforms need to be built up a lot higher than we typically see to accommodate 200 to 300 mils of insulation. Another critical element to the thermal envelope is that you'll often find there'll be a conditioned room above a non-conditioned garage. So it may even be a master bedroom typically. So being non-conditioned below and conditioned above, we need to fully insulate the floor zone between the first floor and the garage. In this case, our airtight layer is going to be our panel flooring to the room above. So that's our airtight barrier. In all cases, we need the insulation to be hard to the airtight barrier. So in this case, where you will have 300 to 400 mils of what we'll call floor zone, we need to fill that zone 300 and 400 mils deep with insulation so that it's pushed hard against the underside of the panel flooring to the conditioned room above. This will require not a single bat, but most likely two bats. It might be two ceiling bats or a combination of a ceiling bat and a wall bat to fill up that 300 to 400 mil zone. Making sure the insulation is hard to the underside of the floor above so that we have that air barrier hard to our insulation zone. And again, it's fully insulated. We're moving on to cathedral ceilings where there is a vertical wall component, and this wall component is part of the ceiling system. This will also occur within things like skylight shafts or any recesses up into your ceiling and roof cavity. So the important fact here is that yes, obviously they need to be insulated. Generally, it'll be a 90 mil stud wall. We need to make sure the insulation that's introduced into this vertical stud wall is a high performance bat. So that high performance bat is going to be a 90 mil thick R2.5 or an R2.7 glass wall. Now, because it's a vertical wall, there'll be no wall lining to the rear, so they'll need to be strapped in place to make sure that over time they certainly do not fall into the ceiling cavity and you lose the thermal performance of the bat and the system. Again, nice and tight, flush with the face of the stud work, strapped from behind. We are now going to talk about a very important component of our roof ceiling insulation. This is critical because what you'll find is your building documentation, your energy rating will call up a ceiling bat. It may be a R4, R5, R6. Those bats are 200, 250 and nearly 300 mils thick. So let me show you that if in this case, this is an R4 200 mil bat. If I pull that out and imagine that being installed in a ceiling, you can see that it has to be compressed into place around the eaves, in which case what it's doing is stifling any airflow into the roof cavity. So the requirement is that the specified bat can only be installed to a point where it maintains a minimum 25 mil clearance to the underside of the roof for what we call roof ventilation. So what's the answer? The answer is we're not going to leave this uninsulated, this perimeter of the building. So there's a requirement to introduce a perimeter bat. Very simply, I'm going to suggest we take a wall bat, a 90 mil thick wall bat. Now it gets installed first around the perimeter of the building, being only 90 mil thick rather than possibly the 200 mil thick of the body of the ceiling insulation. It sits in place and it can be a half bat, so all the common bats are cut into a half, so that it sits around the perimeter, maintaining that airflow between the insulation and the underside of the roof. So a perimeter bat, let's call it a half size bat, half length, followed by your R4, R5, possibly R6 bat, maintaining that airspace of 25 mil throughout. Then we get nice clean airflow from the eaves. Hopefully there are eaves vents and ventilation potential in the eaves itself. You may have a roof vent at the top. So now we get that relief air coming from the eaves and the roof cavity itself is freely ventilated. This is critical because there is a significant health issue. You stifle airflow to a roof space, you will build up moisture, creates condensation, and that may very well grow mold in your roof. So that's a significant health issue. The reason for the perimeter bat is to maintain the airflow, to eliminate mold and any health issue associated with excessive moisture buildup in the roof cavity. In the next video to this series, we're going to look at achieving the best level of air tightness using plasterboard as the air barrier.